Look, you know this town from different ages, different times in your life, right?
Yes. Yes.
What is it like for you at this point in time in your life to be back in Miami?
Well, you know what? And this is a great city. It's just one of the greatest cities in the world, man. And I love Miami. I always tell kids that I talk to all the time because they're trying to tell me, I got a choice from what school I'm going to. I said, well, tell me your choices. Well, it's West Virginia. I said, stop. I said, you just answered your own question. You're telling me your choice is West Virginia or Miami. So the next 4 years, if you go to West Virginia and you tear it up, I mean, you play great. You win 3 national championships. And when you leave in 4 years, you're never going back to West Virginia. So you get 4 years of West Virginia, and that's it. But if you go do this thing in Miami and you play great and you win championships in Miami, when after 4 years, you're still going to go back to Miami, or your family's going to Miami. You get to live off that for the next 40 years. Think long term, not small term, not short term. That's why. Why would you not pick Miami over some of these places, man? It's the greatest place in the world. And if you can play football and get here to play football and own this city, now you own something.
It's a series of great points that you made, not just about Miami, but about what you actually get from the stardom that you build in playing college football.
Right. You know, right here, I'm in my family, if I can call people now and say, hey, man, you know, I got my brother here, my sister here, or my niece here, my nephew there. Can you help them get a job? Michael, for you? Yeah, you know, because they remember the great days. Right. They remember the great days. Nobody's going to West Virginia or any place like that. So I can't use it after I'm done playing. It's not about go to a place where you can use them, not just them use you.
I want to ask you about the death of Kobe Bryant.
Oh, my God, yeah.
First, where were you when you found out?
Actually, I was going through the airport getting ready to fly here. And somebody called me and told me, I said, man, stop playing, man. You know, he said, no, man. I said, that's probably not even real. And he said, you know what? Let me check on it. You're right. I should have made sure before I called you. And then, so he hung up the phone, and then he called right back. He said, Mike, no, it's real. And I'm telling you, man, there was just a sinking in the heart. And you know it, man. We know it. I see it all the time because, you know, you deal with death. It's just the reality of life. But and every time somebody dies, I always say, look at this, man. The world just keeps going. You know, nobody stops. The world just keeps going. But with Kobe, I felt like the world should have stopped. And honestly, the response that you got, it felt like the world stopped for a moment. Everybody felt the pain of losing Kobe, man, and it was just sad. It's sad, man. You think about his daughter and everything. It just hurts. It really put a cloud over Monday and really even the day. And we're starting to try to lift and even get back to laughing some, but it's been hard.
There is something, though, about his life, and there's a bit of a mirror with yours, right? Everybody in their, you know, early, you know, in their 20s, you know, you're trying to kind of figure it out, and you're thrust into, I mean, you were a superstar on the biggest stage on earth, winning Super Bowl after Super Bowl after Super Bowl. And because we as fans or when their media members follow you, you know, there's a tendency to dwell on bad moments. But he turned a corner, and there's a part of you where, you know, you had your own ups and downs,
right?
But now you're kind of a beloved figure, and people remember the greatness and the great plays and enjoy your personality. What is that like to be a part of, to have your kind of personal evolution and be such a big figure, though everybody watches you go through it?
And what you're talking about is really walking out your life in front of everybody, growing in front of everybody. Some people, because they don't do what we do, you know, what Kobe did, or to a lesser degree what I do, playing ball, football, they don't do it. So they get to have those quiet moments to grow and mature and to develop. You don't get those quiet moments. Kobe didn't get those quiet moments. We grew up with Kobe.
Yeah.
We watched when he shot air balls and when he was just got fresh out of high school, 18-year-old playing. And I remember when I saw him shoot those air balls in that game in Utah, I said, oh, my God. First of all, it took such guts to take that shot as a young kid. You know that will either make you or break you. I remember, as God is my witness, I remember saying, that kid's going to be one of the greatest of all time because he had the guts to take the shot. And, you know, and he came back and took another one. He airballed that. So you knew that was going to push him. But yeah, watching his whole life, and to an extent people have watched mine, that's why I'm okay with being open and talking about everything. Listen, every time I see a young picture of me, I just want to slap that fellow around a little bit myself. I want to whoop his tail for spending some of my money and some of the decisions he made. But the reality is, when I think back to that young fella, he thought he really knew. Yeah. I know now that he was a dummy, but he thought he really knew then. And it's just funny to watch the evolution of it.
And you wouldn't be maybe who you are and what you are today if not for those experiences, the ups and
downs. Because people connect to people. I'm telling you right now.
Because it's real.
Because of the struggle.
Yes.
Because now they can say, hey, I'll listen to you because I knew you went through something.
Yes.
And now I want you to tell me how to come out of what I'm going through right now. It's amazing how that happens.
I want to talk just very quickly about this game.
Yeah.
You have Pat Mahomes, but we've seen this before, okay? We've seen whether it was your Cowboys teams and against the Bills where the best offense comes in and – we're so enamored by quarterbacks, whether it's Peyton a couple years ago against Seattle,
right.
Whether it's the Broncos and John Elway, the Patriots when they lost to the Giants. And, you know, like cliche is like defense wins championships. It does feel like we're that weapon of Pat Mahomes and all of those wide receivers and Travis Kelce tight end against a real legit team that's going to get after him. Is that a fair?
But sometimes we've seen it. What's interesting now is these new rules. The new rules really help that offense now. Really helps. You bring in a number one defense, you play a number one offense, so you bring a great defense, play a great offense, especially when you can separate from ball. Back in the day, you could separate from ball. With this kind of speed that they have now on Kansas City and the rules that they have where you cannot touch a receiver, you got to give him opportunity to catch the ball. You know, defenseless receiver. And then you got a guy like Patrick Mahomes throwing that ball. Man, it's phenomenal. I hope people understand what you're seeing with Patrick Mahomes. You're seeing an evolution at the position. We watch as Larry Bird shot that perfect form three-pointer. And now we see as Steph Curry barely touches the football. Barely touches the ball.
Yeah.
And Patrick Mahomes has taken the quarterback position kind of like Steph Curry took the three-pointer.
I would agree.
And he's throwing all – and throwing – looking over here, throwing that way. All the things that you used to do to get tips from your quarterback. Let me watch his eyes. He's looking over here, throwing over there now. So it's a great gift and a blessing to watch it. I do like what San Francisco's doing on defense. I love what Bosa did. I watched this kid in high school, and I can't wait to see that matchup between Bosa and Mahomes.
All right, last thing. I know you got to run. You're a busy guy. The Cowboys' plan appears to be, right, keep everything intact. I mean, I'm guessing they're going to re-sign Amari and find a way to get Dak done as well, right? To keep everything offensively, same play caller. You bring in Mike McCarthy, and then defensively, Mike Nolan's going to change some things that maybe fits it. Do you like the plan?
I like some of the plan. I do think bringing in Mike McCarthy was a good idea because this team needs someone that has traveled the path,
right?
So they can believe in the path that they're traveling.
Right.
So
you can't say, trust me, I've done this, unless you've actually done it.
How can I tell you what I do not know?
Right.
How can I take you where I did not go? And he has gone there. So now he won't put a fear in them, but maybe they'll gain a reverence for that and follow him. Because they have the skill set. I believe they have the talent to get there. And I like that they kept Kellen Moore. Dak just had his best year. Let's not scrap everything and then throw a whole new offense at him and get him starting over. Let's make sure we amalgamize, make an amalgamation of what old offense was, what you want to do, and grow him to that new offense, not just throw him in that new offense.
He's a Hall of Famer. He's a playmaker. He's back home. You'll see him on the NFL Network. He's Michael Irvin. Thanks so much for joining us.
Doug, always good to talk with you, buddy. Always good, man. Keep doing your thing, buddy.
Hey, what up? Doug Gottlieb here. Make sure you subscribe to our YouTube channel here at Fox Sports Radio. You can catch my show, all the shows on Fox Sports Radio, unique interviews, strong takes, just interesting discussion on the sports topic of the day, of the week, of the month. It's all encompassing. It's everything you need right here on YouTube. Subscribe.